Alright guys, before we move on, if you want to practice these questions using artificial intelligence and see what mistakes you're making, what score you are likely to get in the test, I have got a great news for you. You can practice all these questions with AI on our app, LAPT Exam Practice App, which is available on iOS and Android as well. Plus, if you want to take a full scored mock test, one free full scored mock test is available in the app, or you can register on languageacademy.com.au. The scorecard you will get with the mock test will be as similar as what you'll get in the actual test, and which will make it very clear what score you are likely to get. I'll highly recommend each and every one of you to take that mock test, see what mistakes you're making, how to improve, and what other things you need to work on. Lastly, we have got our branches in Australia and in India, and we do provide online classes. If you need any help, do contact us on the numbers below. Now you can continue with the video.
Even though our computers are now better than 15 years ago, they still malfunction between 11 and 20% of the time, a new study concludes. The researchers behind the study therefore find that there are major gains to be achieved for society by rethinking the systems and involving users more in their development. Using the Maroon X instrument on the Gemini North telescope, the team was able to identify and measure the abundance of 11 chemical elements in the atmosphere of the planet. Those include rock-forming elements whose abundances are not even known for giant planets in the solar system, such as Jupiter or Saturn. A team of researchers has announced the creation of a novel composite material with the ability to alter its properties based on temperature changes, allowing it to execute specific tasks. These materials are expected to be incorporated into the next wave of self-governing robotics that can engage with the surrounding environment. The new analysis of frailties within the UK's food system has been led by researchers from the University of York and Anglia Ruskin University, and is published in the journal Sustainability. In the study, civil unrest is classified as over 30,000 people in the UK suffering violent injury in 1 year through events such as demonstrations and violent looting.
A new study has provided valuable insights into the Roosmalen's dwarf porcupine, a neotropical species that has been poorly understood until now. This research, conducted after 22 years of limited knowledge, reveals important information about its distribution, evolutionary relationships, and potential risks to its conservation. A groundbreaking study on recent evolutionary changes in natural populations has been conducted by a team of international researchers. The study utilized a vast genomic dataset, one of the largest ever assembled for animals in their natural habitat, which included almost 4,000 Darwin's finches.
We offer databases and educational resources to students of all ages. We offer databases and educational resources to students of all ages. The money was distributed among schools in this rural area. The money was distributed among schools in this rural area. She had the advantage of a good education over others. She had the advantage of a good education over others. Our degree is built to prepare you for your career at sea. Our degree is built to prepare you for your career at sea. I was granted permission to visit the palace last week. I was granted permission to visit the palace last week. Students who study overseas can significantly improve work chances. Students who study overseas can significantly improve work chances. Basic human rights, including freedom of speech, are now guaranteed. Basic human rights, including freedom of speech, are now guaranteed. The team has made some minor changes to the new program. The team has made some minor changes to the new program. Sleep is believed to play a critical role in storing memories. Sleep is believed to play a critical role in storing memories. We need to develop a coordinated approach to the problem. We need to develop a coordinated approach to the problem. Airlines can make a lot of money by flying to the right places. British Airways, for example, long ago cemented themselves as the leader on the London Heathrow to New York JKF route, and flying between these two airports now earns them over $1 billion per year. That's more than any airline makes on any other route in the world. Conversely, though, airlines can lose a lot of money by flying to the wrong places. American Airlines, for example, recently canceled their Chicago to Beijing flight as it was losing them tens of millions of dollars per year. Now, the fact that this route failed might be puzzling, considering it flew between the world's 50th and the world's 7th largest city. Even more, they were flying the 787-8 Dreamliner, the smallest plane they could on this route. Nonetheless, it was truly a financial disaster. The airline said that, in terms of annual revenue, the route was $80 million away from their target. The truth is that deciding where to fly is a lot more complicated than pairing up the largest cities. It's an art that people spend their whole lives mastering, and the difference between an airline that's good at route planning and one that's bad. This can be the difference between a profitable airline and a defunct one.
Hair loss can be a sensitive topic for a lot of people. While certain life events and old age can lead to hair loss, sometimes it can be caused by a health condition. One such condition is alopecia areata. Alopecia areata is a condition that can cause your hair to fall out more than normal. The average person can pretty easily lose up to around 100 pieces of hair a day from their scalp, with most of that growing back. Alopecia areata is when that hair loss gets more significant and you have trouble getting that hair to grow back. The amount of hair that falls out varies from person to person, but it can be anything from small, rather unnoticeable patches, to greater amounts of hair loss as the patches increase in size and connect with each other. We often think of this as hair loss relating to what's on top of your head, but this condition can also include hair loss in places like your eyebrows and eyelashes, as well as your face and other parts of your body. According to the National Alopecia Areata Foundation, this condition is fairly common, affecting as many as 6.8 million Americans, with a lifetime risk of 2.1%. While there is no cure, symptoms can come and go. It might develop slowly, then go away for a few years before coming back. Alopecia areata can lead to alopecia totalis, where you lose all of the hair on your scalp, or alopecia universalis, where you have total hair loss. Generally, when and if your hair ever does grow back, it might fall out again later on. It often first shows up with children, but can begin in any age group.
What is the term for a large crack or opening in the Earth's surface? What is the term for a large crack or opening in the Earth's surface? Crevice. What is the term for a prolonged period of abnormally low rainfall? What is the term for a prolonged period of abnormally low rainfall? Drought.
What is the term for the measure of the amount of water vapor in the air? What is the term for the measure of the amount of water vapor in the air? Humidity. What is the term for a soldier who serves on foot? What is the term for a soldier who serves on foot? Infantry. What do we call the military forces that conduct operations on water? What do we call the military forces that conduct operations on water? Navy. What do you call a large, luxurious apartment in a city? What do you call a large, luxurious apartment in a city? Penthouse.
In our fast-paced, ever-changing world, resilience has become more crucial than ever. Resilience is not about avoiding difficulties, but about navigating through them. It's the skill to bounce back from adversity, a trait that can be developed and strengthened over time. For example, someone who overcomes a personal loss and finds a way to grow from the experience demonstrates high resilience. But how do we cultivate this resilience? It begins with fostering a positive mindset, practicing self-care, and building strong social connections. Mindfulness and cognitive behavioral techniques can also be instrumental in developing coping strategies. Furthermore, resilience isn't just an individual journey. Supportive environments, whether in families, workplaces, or communities, play a vital role in nurturing resilience. Recognizing and managing stress, providing emotional support, and encouraging open communication are key factors. Understanding and developing psychological resilience can profoundly impact our well-being. It equips us to handle life's challenges more effectively, leading to improved mental health and overall life satisfaction.
Sustainable tourism is a vital concept in the modern travel industry. As we explore new places and cultures, it's crucial to consider the impact our travel has on the environment, local communities, and economies. Sustainable tourism is about more than just reducing carbon footprints. It's about preserving the natural and cultural heritage of the destinations we visit. For instance, ecotourism initiatives, which focus on conservation and supporting local communities, are becoming increasingly popular. These initiatives not only protect natural habitats but also provide economic benefits to local residents. However, the challenge of sustainable tourism goes beyond individual actions. It requires collaboration between governments, tourism operators, and travelers. For example, creating policies that limit the environmental impact of tourism, promoting local businesses, and educating tourists on responsible travel practices are essential steps. In a world facing environmental challenges and cultural homogenization, sustainable tourism offers a path to enjoy the world's beauty while protecting it for future generations. By choosing to travel sustainably, we're not just tourists, we're guardians of the world's diverse and precious cultures and ecosystems.
Taking a course, listen to a conversation between a student and a clerk and answer the question. At number 79. Please. Hi there. That's me. I'm number 79. How can I help you? I'd like to register for a course in this department, but I'm in med school. Ah, that explains why you don't look familiar. I think I know all the faces and engineering. Which course are you interested in? Engineering Science 1 MAC 221. We don't get many students from outside the department interested in that course, especially from the medical angle. I'm interested in cybernetic organisms. You know, like that old television show where the hero is half human and half mechanical. It's just advanced prosthetics. Really, see? Well, you probably saw in the course description that there are several prerequisites and a co-requisite course. A lot of math and physics. Right? Well, I was wondering if there can be any exceptions on that. Can I get permission to take the course without having taken those other courses? And I suppose it may be possible, but as it's a compulsory course, it's usually quite full. And the fact we don't want unprepared students slowing the class down. Have you considered ordering the course? You could order the course. And if you feel confident enough, maybe you could challenge the exam. Well, I hadn't thought of that. I don't actually need the credit. So that might work for me. I'll go get a coffee and think about it. Thanks. You're welcome. I'll see you later.
Space War. Listen to part of a lecture in an international politics class and answer the question: space became another arena for competition. After the Soviet Union launched Sputnik, an artificial satellite, in 1957, Americans felt humiliated. The Soviets launched a rocket that could have easily carried a nuclear bomb. The United States did not even launch its first satellite, Explorer 1, until 1958. The already gloomy public mood took a turn for the worse when the Soviets placed the first man in orbit in 1961. President Kennedy's answer to this was to commit the United States to land a man on the moon and bring him back before this decade is out. In August 1962, John H. Glenn Jr. was the first American to orbit the Earth in the mid-1960s. U.S. scientists used the Gemini program to look at the effects of extended spaceflight on man. Gemini Latin for twins carry two astronauts, one more than the earlier Mercury series and one less than the Apollo spacecraft. Gemini achieved several first 8-day mission in August 1965, the longest spaceflight at that time, and in November 1966, the first automatically controlled re-entry into the Earth's atmosphere. Gemini also accomplished the first manned link-up of two spacecraft in flight, as well as the first U.S. walks in space. The Apollo project achieved Kennedy's goal in July 1969, with hundreds of millions of television viewers watching around the world. Neil Armstrong became the first human to walk on the surface of the moon.
Within the past few minutes, the Election Commission in Kenya has declared that Tuesday's presidential election was won by the incumbent Uhuru Kenyatta. The opposition, which has complained fraud, has rejected the results. An opposition spokesman described the process as a masquerade. World leaders have expressed concern of the war of words between Washington and Pyongyang over North Korea's nuclear program. After President Trump said the U.S. military was locked and loaded, North Korea accused him of driving the situation to the brink of nuclear war. Russia, China, and Germany have all appealed the calm and further diplomatic efforts. First, though, the U.S. government has released its monthly jobs report. It's one measure of how the economy as a whole is doing. The report that just came out is for the month of September, and it was a disappointment. Economists had expected that 479,000 jobs would have been added last month. The actual number was well below half that, according to the U.S. Labor Department. It was the second month in a row that the number of jobs added to the American economy was dramatically lower than what economists predicted, and no one knows exactly why the growth in this area has slowed down. Many economists point to continued concerns about the coronavirus pandemic and the Delta variant of the disease. The enduring defeat of ISIS remains a top priority for the United States. The U.S.-led Global Coalition to Defeat ISIS is leading stabilization efforts that consolidate military gains, restore basic essential services, and enable Syrians to voluntarily and safely return to their homes in Raqqa and other former ISIS strongholds. Assistance includes explosive hazard and rubble removal, providing clean water, rehabilitating electricity networks, and other basic necessities. Since April, the United States has elicited approximately $300 million in contributions and pledges from coalition partners to support immediate stabilization and early recovery initiatives in areas liberated from ISIS in northeast Syria.
I want to take a quick look at how material culture, that is, the things or objects we value and use, tools, technology, etc., affects the non-material culture, our customs, behavior, beliefs, attitudes, and so on. Now, of course, it works both ways. If you were, say, 18 years old when mobile phones became widespread or when almost every home had a computer, you must have noticed a fairly significant change in people's attitudes and behavior, including your own. These two technological innovations were readily accepted and considered very much a positive contribution to culture. On the other hand, there is the way in which our attitudes and beliefs have an effect on the material culture. Take, for example, genetic science. While many, if not most, people welcome the advances made in this field, from the discovery of DNA to the genome project and cracking the genetic code, with its promise of finding cures for diseases that have plagued mankind throughout history, many, too, object to the idea of cloning. This is not just because they fear, without reason, that it will mean creating a race of identical people if it gets into the wrong hands, but simply because it is, in their opinion, unnatural. It goes against everything they believe in. Similarly, there are many who object to genetically modified food, even when they are told it might be the only way to feed a rapidly growing global population.
Genealogy can be defined as the compilation of information necessary to construct what is usually known as a family tree, our pedigree, or our ancestry. It is a chart which shows the relationships between individual people in an extended family over a period of time. The first records of genealogy can be traced back to the earliest civilizations in northern Africa, who recorded successions of dynasties and wealthy families reaching back hundreds of years. This was usually done to establish rights to title, land, and property. There is evidence that this happened in many places in the world. However, it was the domain of the wealthy, and few people outside those circles were even aware that family ancestry could be recorded and traced. This situation changed in the early 19th century when genealogy became more generally well known after the first practical guide to research was published. But it was not until the mid-20th century that family history was no longer solely devoted to tracing the genealogies of the great, the wealthy, or the famous, and it became a more common activity among the general population.
In small doses, stress can have quite a positive effect. It can make you feel more alive, even exhilarated. I suppose everyone has a set level at which stress becomes unbearable, at which point they cease to function properly. I suppose, too, that it's possible for someone to train themselves to be able to take higher levels of stress by repeatedly putting themselves in a stressful situation to build up a tolerance for stress. Indeed, some jobs absolutely require this. But stress is a fact of life for all of us and, as the figures show, its effect is largely negative. Each year, about 6 million people in Britain consult their doctors because they feel stress or anxiety, and it is estimated that at least another 6 million suffer from stress-related illness but do not seek medical advice. Long working hours, fear of losing their jobs, the difficult journey to and wrong work in crowded trains and buses, all contribute to increased levels of stress. Then there are domestic problems, such as a large mortgage on the house, children who want to drop out of school and join rock bands, not enough time to spare to be with the family.
The nature-nurture debate is still going on. It is not a question of taking sides, because we know that both play an important part in what makes us who we are. It is more a question of emphasis, which of them has the greatest influence. On the nature side, we have what we get from our genes, our inherited traits, eye color, and other physical traits, for example, but also, some believe, non-physical ones, such as temperament. For example, you might be quick to anger, or have a nervous temperament, and this even extends to sense of humor. On the nurture side, there is what we get from our environment and our upbringing, what we learn. Research in LOW, the human genome, has recently made it clear that both sides are partly right. Nature gives us inborn abilities and traits, while nurture takes these genetic tendencies and shapes them as we grow and learn and mature. This is an important point as it means, contrary to the belief of some, that we are not wholly determined by our genes. Scientists have known for years that eye and hair color are determined by specific genes, but some now claim that such traits as intelligence and personality are also encoded in our genes. In 19th century Britain, and indeed in the first half of the 20th century, many of the urban poor lived in extremely cramped conditions. Overcrowding, damp, and poor sanitation affected the daily lives of the majority of the population, with serious implications for their own and their children's health. Novelists have a major role to play in reflecting their times to their readers, who may otherwise ignore social problems. And the portrayal of the wretched living conditions of the impoverished by such writers as Charles Dickens in the 19th century and George Orwell in the 20th was instrumental in.
This year, we're planning to use a different type of assessment on this module. In the past, students were required to complete two long written assignments and also to do a presentation on a subject of their own choice. We have decided to ask you to write four shorter pieces of written coursework this year. We are also going to be more prescriptive about what you focus on in your presentation. This is because previously many students lost marks unnecessarily simply because sleep. There's nothing better than a nice, long, uninterrupted I can't sleep when there's but dia ever notice, noise doesn't wake everyone. Now scientists have a better idea why, because sound sleepers show a certain brain rhythm when they doze. Findings published in the journal Current Biology. To study the brain waves of a good night's sleep, scientists invited volunteers to snooze in the lab. While the subjects caught some ZS, the researchers monitored their brain activity. They then subjected the sleepers to noise, and they found that those who were able to slumber straight through all the showed more short bursts of faster brain waves. This activity, the scientists say, is the brain's way of blocking out the and the while you're trying to rest. The scientists don't yet know of any way to boost those sleep-saving brainwaves.
That grinning, glowing, globular invader of your living room is an inhabitant of the pumpkin patch. And if your doorbell rings and nobody's there, that was no Martian, it's Halloween. That's how Orson Welles ended his Mercury Theater version of H.G. Wells' War of the Worlds on October 30, 1938. The broadcast was designed to sound like live news coverage of an invasion of Earth by Martians. And a lot of people fell for it. Now there's some more Martian misinformation fooling folks. This one's not so scary. A lot of people are getting email claiming that in the next few weeks, the planet Mars will get close enough to the Earth so that it will appear to be about the same size as the Moon. Our friends at Sky and Telescope magazine report that email dating back to 2003 mentioned that in a 75x magnifying telescope, Mars would look about as big as the Moon does to the naked eye. Recession triggers exciting creativity and high rates of public wisdom. Recession triggers exciting creativity and high rates of public wisdom. This section includes a series of team building activities in school. This section includes a series of team building activities in school. He always attempted to win international support for his company. He always attempted to win international support for his company. Teachers can help determine what the students need to study. Teachers can help determine what the students need to study.
I have scored 73 in my PTE in only 10 days.
I achieved my desired score just in 20 days.
My desired score.
Desired score.
My desired score.
Desired PTE score.
Desired score.
Desired score.
Desired score.
Desired score.
My desired score.
Language Academy to achieve kita hai.